legacies, an ecological interpretation of the Constitution. Frank has taught American government, American political thoughts, constitutional law, and a number of environmental studies programs. I will tell you that today's program and the other four series will be videotaped, and we will be putting them up on our website for folks who weren't able to get here. So I would ask if anybody has any recording devices to please turn them off. If you have a phone, please turn that off or put it on vibrate, just so we're not disturbed. I will tell you that it's very highly likely that the train will go by and make noise, so we just won't compete with them. If anybody needs restroom facilities, they're down the corridor. It's the second door on the right. We have both men and women facilities. We have lots of information here, lots of historic photographs, lots of things that you can look at, so I hope that you'll tour the building when we're done. The idea is that Frank's going to talk for about 45 minutes or so, and then we're just going to have a few-minute break, and then a lot of question and answer and dialogue is what we're looking for. Frank did prepare a handout for you, and there should be one on every chair, and it's got a table of contents of the book, and how that table of contents relates to the series of lectures that he's going to be giving here, and what the dates are. So with that, I thank you very much, and I welcome Frank. Thank you.
Thank you.
I thought this would help and kind of get us going. This is a book I've been working on for decades now, it seems like, and this is the latest table of contents. So this gives you some idea of what we're going to talk about. On the other side is the lecture dates, the five lectures we're going to give here, and the dates. To help you understand, today I'm going to be discussing what is amounts to a synopsis of chapters 3 and 4. We're skipping 1 and 2. and then on March 22nd, we're going to do chapter 5. We're going to look specifically at the American Constitution and see how policies are made. Then we're going to turn our attention to American thought, American values, and try to understand how that Constitution and those values impact how we deal with the environment. To help you with that, on April 26th, I'm going to give a real quick synopsis of where the current studies on American political thought are. And then on May 31st, my hot one. A title I stole from a friend of mine, Two Dreams and a Nightmare. Those are the environmental legacies of Alexander Hamilton, Thomas Jefferson, and James Madison. Coming to bring to get rid of your suspicions, the two dreams are Hamilton and Jefferson, the nightmare is Madison. and then I think for the last lecture, I'd like to talk about what's happened to the Constitution, what's happened to how we're dealing with the environment over the past, to begin with, 100 years, because that Gilded Age is really important. That's when the conservation movement and all that got going. And then let's look at it, and then finally, let's look at it today, although we'll probably be hitting that all through it, and see where environmental politics is today, and the impact that our Constitution system. And let me say, probably at the beginning, I use the word Constitution in two different senses. First, the American sense, which is that written document that we all know and studied in high school and college. But there's another sense of the Constitution. That's the British sense of the Constitution. That's our unwritten document. That's our values, our perspective. Probably the best way to put it is our culture. The British talk about their Constitution. Of course, they don't have a written Constitution. But when they talk about their Constitution, they mean basically their cultural values. And I use it the term in both senses. Okay. We're going to get started then. Oh, I see what you mean about the train.
We think that the prophets is bugged and they say, oh, the meeting's about to start, bring the train.
What I'm going to try to do today is something impossible. And that's to summarize what is two chapters of my book. In an earlier iteration, it was three chapters. Believe it or not, I've narrowed it down. These are the three chapters I'm going to discuss today. It's 228 pages in a rough draft. So, So what I'm going to do is I want to talk about what I'm going to talk about and what I'm going to save for the discussion. I figured we could do that. Let me begin where I begin a lot of my classes, and that's making a distinction between policy and politics. Okay? Policy is the regular course of action we use to address issues. I mean, you know, every time this happens, we're going to do this. That's your policy. Okay? But before we have policy, we must have politics. Politics is, what's the problem you think we need to address? Who supports these policies? Who supports these policies? Politics is that debate we have about what the issue is going to be. What are we going to make policy about? Does that make sense to you? And when it comes to the environment, you sometimes wonder if all these people are talking about the same planet. There are probably literally thousands and thousands of books that have been written about the environment. And if you listen to public speakers or news media or anything like that, you start to wonder, my gosh, can't all these people agree on anything? The answer is no. Right? So to understand the debate that we're having in this country, I think one of the good ways to do it is let's look at the different perspectives that people have on the issue of the environment. Does that make sense? And I want to briefly, you know, cover all these from the far right to the far left. Okay? How do you look at environmental politics? What's some way that we can put this in some sort of organized fashion? It seems to me the first thing we can do is just to be easy, put a name on these things. You know, when you hear people talking about environmental economics or sustainable development or libertarian free market approaches, who are these people? What institutions, what organizations back them? Okay? What are some of the major spokesmen and spokeswomen for these perspectives? So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to name them, and then we're going to give their perspectives. Then the next thing is, I think, is really key. I used to tell my students, whenever you're talking about the environment with somebody, ask yourself this question. What is the problem that they think we need to solve? Okay? You know, and I think if you ask them that, what problem do you think we need to solve? Then you start to get a grip on where they're coming from. Then I often tell people, when people fall into these discourses, they'll start using patterns of language. They'll start having kind of repetitious phrases they use. Listen for the buzzwords. Listen for the language and the terms they use to describe their position, and I think you can find out a lot about it. And then finally, the question we really, really need to ask is, what policies do these people recommend for dealing with it? Okay? Those are the ones, and I think we have that. That'll give us a pretty broad overview. Now let's talk about what we're not going to talk about right off. The most important thing is, what assumptions do they bring to their argument? What logic do they use? What evidence do they use? And I mean, we could go, this is what the 228 pages is about, all right? Maybe some of these perspectives you'll find more interesting than others, so I'll hold off and we can discuss that in the second portion of the lecture. The second thing we need to ask ourselves is, what are the consequences of believing this? If you adopt this perspective, and if you push these policies, what's going to be the impact of that? Okay? And then the third thing I think we could talk about if we wanted to, what are the strengths and what are the weaknesses of each perspective? Okay? So let's hold off on those three and just deal with those, you know, kind of an outline of each. Does that make sense? Okay. Then let me grab my magic marker and get started. We can start with the far. I'm going to do this right to left for political reasons. We can start off with the far right, and I'll probably there's by the way there's 10 of them if you'll wonder, and we can go all the way over to the left. One of the things that can help us organize this right off is we begin to notice one thing, and that is their attitudes of these various perspectives to the major institutions of American politics. Okay, and the major institutions in America, we can
I break down into three broad categories. First, our economic institutions, which we might call technological capitalism. Fair? The second group, we can call our political institutions. And those we can call constitutional democracy. Okay? The third is a little bit more difficult, but it's important. It's our ethical foundations. And it's tough because to try to come up with one concept that can kind of encompass almost everybody in America's ethics. And if we could do that, I think the broadest term we could give is individual humanism. America is an intensely individual country, individualistic country. If you ask somebody, who are you? You know, if you ask an American, who are you? How many of them are going to answer, I'm a member of the working class? You know, they're going to say, well, I'm Frank. I'm just me. And that individualism gets pushed over and over again. And humanism is a broad term and certainly includes all of our major religions, where that believe that humans are different from and in many ways superior to all the other species. Yes? So here's the first question we have to ask. To what extent can we address and solve our environmental problems within those three sets of institutions? To what extent, one way or the other, are those three institutions causing the problems? Okay? And that's a different thing. Those people that believe that you can address these issues within our current economic, political, and ethical system often use the phrase environmental problems. Okay? Those people who think that, to some extent, technological capitalism, constitutional democracy, and humanistic ethics are causing the problems, they are more likely to use the phrase environmental crisis. See this? One set thinks that we're doing something wrong in an otherwise perfectly functional set of institutions. The other set thinks that it's the institutions themselves that are driving us into crisis. So, if you would, the first distinction we can make is between all those groups, all those perspectives, all those environmental politics that think that we can somehow solve the problem. Of course, it all depends how you define the problem. If we can solve that problem within our given institutions, we can call those mainstream. Yes, this is mainstream environmental politics. Those that think that our institutions are primarily causing the crisis, we can call, and here's the problem right off, but I can't think of a different name for it, we can call those radical environmentalists. Okay? So the first thing we have to ask, so when you're talking about environmental politics, you have to ask, are these people mainstream, okay, or are they radical? Okay? Let's begin. Most Americans, or maybe a lot of Americans, fit in within an environmental perspective. And by the way, my source for a lot of this is an outstanding political scientist named John Dryzak, who probably has contributed as much as anyone to the study of environmental politics. If you want, maybe in some later lecture, I can bring you a reading list or something if you might be interested in that. He calls them, I've called them cornucopias. He calls them Prometheans, after Prometheus. The cornucopian Prometheans have a very simple perspective. They say we have no environmental problems. Okay? There is no crisis of sustainability. There's no scarcity. You'll hear them say things like there's more trees in America now than there was when the white people first arrived. The air's cleaner. The water's cleaner. The only problem we have is a bunch of left-wing, muddling environmentalists that are trying to ruin it for everybody else. Okay? Who are these people? First, it's the Heritage Foundation. It's Fox News. Yes? It's a great many academic economists. Let me give you some other names. It's John Stossel, if you've ever had that terrible experience. I mean, this is where he's coming from. It's Senator James Inhofe, who looked Al Gore in the face and said climate change is the biggest hoax ever perpetuated on the American public. Okay? It's author Michael Crichton. It's Fred Singer and Patrick Michaels. If you don't know those names, those are the two leading environmental climate change deniers who are currently flooding the newsways. Probably more than anybody else, the one that really articulated it was a University of Maryland economics professor by the name of Julian Simon. But the cornucopian position is there is no, we don't have any crisis, we don't even have any problems. Okay? Let's face the facts. There's a lot of people that hold that position. Okay? The buzzwords they use is abundance. The ultimate resource, which they mean technology, human imagination. They talk about technological breakthroughs that are going to solve any problem that comes by down the pike. But the phrase they use more than any other, and this is where you really, they use the phrase, no limits. I used to tell my students, I said, go around and keep track on television programs, advertising, you know, kids wearing shirts that say, no limits. You know, none? You know? Those are the cornucopians, and I think we do a large disservice not to acknowledge their existence. Well, we got to. And in fact, to a large extent, at least apparently in Raleigh, they're running the country. All right? What policies do they recommend? Gutting environmental regulations, repealing environmental regulation. Okay? Deny any sort of serious environmental issues, particularly climate change.
Cost-benefit analysis.
No, hold off on that. Not yet. And attack environmentalists as Chicken Little naysayers. Okay? No, there are, the next group is kind of somewhat willing to acknowledge some problems. These are the free market libertarians. Very often, these two go together, and we'll see why when we get to the policy section, okay? But the free market libertarians, who are they? They're the Cato Institute, all right? If you're ever watching news and they say, we have a spokesman here from the Cato Institute, alarm should go off, okay? Please. They're the Ayn Rand Institute. Okay? For those of you that have some background, it's the Austrian School of Economics. Friedrich Hayek, Ludwig von Mises, those people. They are Ron and Rand Paul. Okay? They're the Tea Party. They're Bjorn Lomborg and Milton Friedman, if you're familiar with any of his economics teaching. Okay? They will say, of course there's scarcity. Here's the difference, a slight difference. These people deny any scarcity. These people say, well, of course there's scarcity. There's always scarcity. But the way you deal with scarcity is by allocating resources and values through free economic markets. And so that's their solution to basically everything. Free economic markets, they argue, are rational. They produce the maximum efficiency. They take individual values and collectivize them into the closest thing to a common good we can have. Okay? And the problem is, for them, government interference in the operation of the free market. If we could just get government out of virtually everything except self-defense in the court system, okay, then all of our problems would go away. Okay? The policies they recommend, the buzzwords, individual rights, which of course is t-
touches a very strong, deep nerve in America when you talk about that. Individual freedom. Limited government, free markets, and private property rights. They take almost any form of environmental regulation or environmental action as an attack on private property rights. Okay, so their policies... Did you have a question?
Let's wait until...
Okay. Basically, their policies they recommend, you can guess. Okay? Very similar here now to these folks. Repeal environmental regulations. Okay? Privatize public resources. Gail Norton was a lawyer before Ronald Reagan put her in charge of our national forest. She was a lawyer for
Colorado.
The Sagebrush Revolution or one of those wise use movement or one of those. And her plan was take all the national parks and all the national forests and sell them off. Because then when they're in the market, their attitude is, look, you want to protect the Arctic National Wildlife Refuge? Buy it. Okay? What's the best use for the Arctic National Wildlife Refuge? Let's open it up for bids. You environmentalists, I mean, they're not opposed to environmentalism in that sense. If you environmentalists can come up with the money,
right,
then go ahead and do it. Now, if Exxon or BP can outbid you, well, that's just the operation of the market. Okay? So, private property rights, privatization. In a few cases, they're willing to admit that if somebody is doing you some harm, we can have trespass. If somebody's polluting your river or stream or backyard or something, then you can have nuisance and trespass suits, and you can take them to court. It isn't going to be all that free market. There's going to be a lot of litigation going on in this system. Okay. Well, I hope you can see that it would be a mistake to ignore either of these groups. They're there. Very powerful and very well placed. Okay, but there are, of course, at least since the early '60s with Rachel Carson and Barry Commoner and Paul Ehrlich. The people are saying, "No, wait a minute. We've got serious. There's serious problems here we need to deal with." And so, after a decade in the 1960s of a rebirth of environmentalism in this country. The 1970s became what was known as the environmental decade. And it was a time when there was a rush of environmental legislation proposed mostly by people that drives that calls reform environmentalists. You think I'm going to spell environmental by now? Reform environmentalists, basically, this is the approach of environmental law. Okay? This is the NRDC. This is the EDF, the Environmental Defense Fund. This is a lot of political scientists. We've kind of shifted here. I mean, in academics, we've kind of shifted from the economists into the political scientists here. Probably the biggest name here, if you're familiar with him, is a Virginia or Maryland professor named Mark Sagoff, who has written, quite eloquently, I think, about this approach, which basically argues that polluting the environment is not just simply uneconomical, it's morally wrong. And that what we're going to do is we're going to stop it. And the way we're going to stop it is through law and regulation. Okay? So according to a lot of reform environmentalists, focus on the issue of pollution, as you can well imagine. Okay, the buzzwords for them are the public interest, as opposed to this individual self-interest that these people are more likely to talk about. They talk about the environmental decade. They'll talk about command and control, direct regulation, which is basically the method in our government by which we regulate enterprises in the private sector. They'll talk about pollution permits.
okay? Which is the way they implement a lot of their strategy. Their policies, because like I said, from 1972 to 1980, there was almost a consensus in America, I think, that we needed something. And so during that decade, more environmental legislation was passed before or since. You've got the Clean Air Act. You've got the Clean Water Act. In many ways, the Endangered Species Act can fit in here. You've got a whole host of legislation, the alphabet soup legislation, to deal with toxic and hazardous materials. You've got TSCA, the Toxic Substance Control Act. You've got RCRA, the Resource Conservation and Recovery Act. You've got CERCLA, which I know what it stands for, but it takes me some time. It's super fun, okay? And so basically, these people were kind of in limbo, and these people in the 70s were taken over. But guess what happened in 1980? Ronald Reagan got elected president, okay? And these people came back in force. And in fact, for a long period of time, basically what environmentalists had to do was struggle to keep those regulations intact, hopefully to revise them as they did the Clean Air Act in 1990. But basically, Ronald Reagan came in, and alas, there are a few of us in this room, I suspect, that remember 1980. He argued that Americans are overtaxed and overregulated. Yes? And so his strategy was to hold back more environmental regulations and kind of move as far in this direction as he possibly can. But heaven bless them, the NRDC and the EEDF put up a tough fight. Then what was necessary was somehow to try to blend these two and have reform environmentalism, have environmental protection, but not that was based on government regulation, but instead was based on market economic principles. And in fact, the slogan became market-based solutions. Okay? And that gave rise to a group called environmental economics. Now this is going to be important because there's going to be a slight change here. Environmental economics. The supporters here are lots. They're basically most academic economics departments today will teach a course in environmental economics. Some of the big textbooks are Evan Goodstein at Bard. Tom Teitenberg was at Colby. Myrick Freeman was at UBC, the other main school. Doesn't matter. He worked inside the Reagan White House, okay? And his policy was EO 12291. Now, EO 12291 basically means all environmental regulations must be subject to cost-benefit analysis. If there's a buzzword that signals you're in the hands of an environmental economist, it's cost-benefit analysis, or benefit-cost analysis. I can never forget the difference. They recognize we must have policies that are cost effective. How much benefit do we get from this policy, and how much does it cost us? Then in moments when it becomes clear that some policy is needed, they're willing to grant market incentives. Again, notice this, it's heavily based in economic markets. But they said, what we can do is we can take the market and tweak it. Or we can take the market and rig it, if you're not, you know. And the way we do this is through what they call, in their language, they call structured tax incentives. Okay? So if you want people to
go solar.
If you want people to go solar, give them a tax break, okay? You want people to protect their land, give them a tax easement, okay? If you want to reduce carbon emissions, put a tax on gasoline, okay? If you want to address stationary sources of pollution, put in a cap and trade system. They are willing to consider all of these if they're cost effective. Okay? So environmental economists, are still obviously highly influential. Okay? Is this helping?
Yes.
Okay. And then in 1987, something happened. It was like, yes, all of this is important, but there's other issues that we need to address. We need to address the issue of how equitable is our economic system in distributing wealth. Okay? Mostly these four were focused on the United States. In 1987, you started getting more interest in third world countries and in developing countries. And in 1987, the United Nations put together a commission to study the worldwide impact that humans were having on the environment. Okay? It went by various names. It was most often referred to by the chairwoman of the department, who was the Norwegian Prime Minister, and her name was Gro Brundtland. Okay? So in 1987, you got the Brundtland Commission, and the Brundtland Commission coined a new phrase that we've all heard over and over again since: sustainable development. The notion of sustainable development was mimicked by the Earth Summit in 1992, the Rio Conference. President Clinton had a commission put out a report called Sustainable America. Okay. This is Al Gore. Okay. This is Thomas Friedman. If you're familiar with Hot, Flat, and the World is Flat, Hot, Flat, and Crowded. Okay. If you watch CNN. Try to break yourself of that habit, and also, but this is Fareed Zakaria. If you listen to him, okay. Their basic assumption is this: that they talk about the three E's, at least the more academic approaches do, and the three E's are the economy, the environment, and equity. Their argument is that there is basically no contradiction between a healthy environment and a growing capitalist economic system. What you need is, in order to have that, you need to have structured incentives underpinned with a good theory, with a good base of environmental regulations. Okay? There's an important shift here. You start getting shifts away from, for instance, end of the pipe approaches like you have with the Clean Air Act and the Clean Water Act. To in 1990, you got the Pollution Prevention Act. You started getting They started talking about things like source reduction. Let's quit making the stuff and try and deal with it afterward. You started getting things like collaborative agreements. Rather than this highly adversarial system that built into the law. Probably if there was one phrase, one buzzword that distinguishes in sustainable development more than any other, it's the notion of smart growth. Okay? The difference is these people are for growth. Now they don't say they're for dumb growth. I've never heard anybody use that expression. But what's the difference between what sustainable development talks about, smart growth, and what they call these people unsustainable growth? And the answer is basically, under sustainable development, you have growth that's managed and directed by the political sphere. Okay?
And it's not unlimited. And it's no longer unlimited.
Well, no, it's interesting. They still hold that it is unlimited. You could have, read Friedman and Zakaria and all of them.
or Brundtland, you know, there are places where they say there's, you know, there are theoretically no limits how much we grow, but it must be efficient. Okay? It must be efficient, it must be planned. It must be managed capital. Okay? I mean, President Obama's State of the Union message. Okay? He was thinner and he talked, thank goodness, a president finally mentions climate change. And he's talking about climate change, and you know, we're sitting there going, go, bro. Within 2 minutes, he's saying, and we need more economic growth. We must spur economic growth in order to address deficits and in order to address our wealth. Okay? You listen to Al Gore. I love that. You listen to Al Gore, and it's like, that's as close to radical as you can get without becoming one. It's like, you know, he was down at Tulane, and he's giving his Inconvenient Truth speech, and he's like, go out. You know? And then it's like, well, how about economic growth? And he says, we do not have to make a choice, his words, we do not have to make a choice between environmental protection and a healthy growing economy. And I think at that point, probably mainstream environmentalism has gone about as far as it can go. Okay. And at some point, people will raise their voice and say, oh yes, we do have to. And so we step across that line and start talking about writers who say, look, this is more than a policy issue, although policy is going to have to come in here. There's something fundamentally dysfunctional about our economic, political, and ethical system. And until we address that, we may be doing some good, no question. But we're not fundamentally addressing the causes of the crisis. And so, the first group of radical environmentalists, and a lot of them wouldn't like being called that, by the way. But it's called ecological economics. Now, if you went to school at Oberlin, or if you went to school at Middlebury, or if you were fortunate enough to go to the University of Vermont and take courses at the Gund Institute, you've been introduced to ecological economics, okay? This is, let me get the names, Robert Costanza, yes? Mm-hmm. Josh Farley, Bill McKibben, who writes for Orion, okay? He's at Middlebury. But probably more than anybody else, the chief name here is Herman Daly. And ecological economics is based upon the assumption. Environmental economics still takes for granted all of the mainstream assumptions of economics that you learn when you're in college. This is still what we call neoclassical economics. Okay? This challenges those basic assumptions. The most basic assumption that they challenge is the notion that you can have infinite exponential economic growth on a finite planet. Okay? Here's a homework assignment for you. Tonight, go online and go, for those of us who went to college, Google the college that you graduated from. Okay? Go to the economics department and see what courses they offer. I'll guarantee you almost everyone will offer a course in environmental economics. How many of colleges today, good colleges, still do not offer a course in ecological economics? It's not that the two schools debate and these people win. There's just no debate. I
before, and I thought about this, so I went online and Googled the University of Delaware, where I graduated from. No, they must teach 40 courses in the economics department. None on ecological economics. When I was at Tulane, I was teaching this, and one of my students raised their hands, how would the economists respond to this? I said, that's a very good question. How many of you are taking economics courses? About a third only answered, raised their hand. I said, here's a homework assignment. And if you want to get a sophomore interested, said, extra credit. that perks up ears. I said, go to your economics professor and ask them, do you think it's possible to have exponential economic growth on a finite planet? Okay. Next class comes in. I had forgotten all about it. Hand goes up in the air. I said, yeah. He says, I did what you told me to do. I asked my professor if he thought it was possible to have exponential growth on a finite planet. I said, oh, good. What did he say? He said, we're not going to talk about that in this class. And I said, well, that's fair enough. I was only a visiting professor, didn't want to get in too much trouble. I said, maybe that topic isn't important or isn't significant to the course. He says, I don't know. It's all we talk about. He says, the whole course is about economic growth. How to promote it? How, you know what? Stimulation, tax breaks, and all this. I said, what did you do? You talk about? Is it possible? I mean, the planet. I'm pretty sure about this. The planet is not growing 3% per year. The economy is, or they hope it is.
Was.
Ecological economics. The reason it's called ecological and not environmental is that they take the issue from biology, from ecology, they take the notion of carrying capacity, okay, and bring it into economics. The other homework assignment I used to give my kids is go to your ecology book, go to your ecology textbook, and flip back in the index and look up carrying capacity. What do you see? They answered, references all over the place to it. I said, good. Now get your economics textbook and open it up to the index, and what do you see there about carrying capacity? And the answer is, never mind, nothing. Okay. Dating back all the way to 1848, one of my favorite people, economist John Stuart Mill, he argued in 1848, look, a growing exponential economy is just one phase of human development. At the end of that phase, there must come another phase, which he called the stationary state. Okay. That was 1848. Okay. Daly, Costanza, the Gundan Institute, they say, look, we have, humans are pushing the carrying capacity of this planet. The reason we keep going, everybody knows the reason we keep going, two words, fossil fuels. Okay. We are drawing down those resources from the future, and we're using them up right now. This is going, in other words, what we've done, another phrase we use, we have overshot the carrying capacity of this planet, which will probably, not probably, will eventually lead to crash. So they ask the question, okay, what would a stationary state, no growth economy look like? None of these people, let's get this out of, set this aside. This has nothing to do with the debate between capitalism and socialism. Okay? It's not about private property, because most socialists, I mean, listen to Francois Hollande in France, are as pro-growth as anybody. They talk about the institutions needed to move towards a no-growth economy. First, you need a set of institutions and a set of policies to guarantee a constant non-growing throughput of resources. Basically, and we could go into this, of course, for a long time. You switch from non-renewables to renewables, and you only use the renewables at the pace at which they can be renewed. Keep a constant state of throughput. And then secondly, you must do something about income inequality. Because it's economic growth. I have a nice little article, at least I'm the only one who's using it. It's on justice. It's economic growth that stops, I think, America from dealing with the issue of income inequality, because we just simply say, hey, everybody can have more. Right? Work hard, invest wisely, everyone can have more. When everyone, and that presupposes a growing economy, when that's no longer possible, then for the first time in this country's history, we're going to have a serious discussion about economic justice. Now, I'm not in favor, personally speaking, of everyone making the same. I think if you work hard, you deserve to get them. But $1 million a day, the average hedge fund operator earns, he gets. Isn't there some cap? And I'm willing to set it pretty high. $5, $6, $10 million a year? If you can't live on $10 million a year, you need to get on a budget.
How about population growth?
And the third thing is they say we must address population growth. Our population to have everyone in this world live at the standard of living of not affluent Americans, you and me, middle-class Americans, to have 8-9 billion people living at that standard of living would take the resources of this plus another 2.5 planets. We are 2.5 planets short. Now let me say this. Ecological economists address that, say it, but they don't get much very deeply into it, and I think it has to do with the third reason, the third perspective. And they talk about democracy. They want a much more democratic, open political system. But what they don't talk is our fundamental ethics. Okay? Herman Daly and his co-author, John Cobb. John Cobb was at Claremont when I was there. He was in the theological school. Okay? Herman Daly, Bill McKibben, are devout Christians. Okay. And when population issues get to be too close to that humanistic ethic, then I think they get uncomfortable, to put it mildly. But I think ecological economics needs to be given serious consideration by anyone who thinks that you can't have exponential growth on a finite planet. And Karen's right. Whether we like it or not, the truth of the matter is we're moving towards a no-growth economy. And that's even using GDP as a measure of growth, which most environmentalists will tell you is a crappy way to measure anything. If you have any real measure of human welfare, Daly's term, we haven't had economic growth. We haven't had growth in this country in 30 years, 40 years. Okay. The next one, perspective, is a little bit strange. I'm probably the only speaker that you're ever going to hear mention this. But I think it still needs to be considered. It's social ecology. For any of these perspectives, I give you a whole bunch of organizations and people that support it. Here, there's one name that stands out far and above everybody else, and that's the late Murray Bookchin, who headed, when I was there, when I was at Goddard, he headed the Institute for Social Ecology at Goddard College. Murray was a strange, strange, irascible, he needed a personality transplant. But he might be one of two or three people in my life that I've ever met that was a genuine bona fide genius. He produced a perspective that is very theoretical. Okay? There's some policy here, but not much. But he says some things that I think we need to talk about. He asked the question, if you ask the question, what's the problem we need to solve? He answers that the problem we need to solve is this. We dominate and oppress nature because we see domination and oppression as the solution to every problem we come across. Every time something goes wrong, it's let's pass a law. Let's increase the size of our military. We have institutions based upon hierarchy, domination. You can see, by the way, this sociology is a lot of ecofeminists are strongly drawn to social ecology perspective. They see the two. The problem that we're having, the crisis we're facing, is human oppression of nature. Nothing makes my teeth grit more than that. IBM commercial that says, let's build a smarter planet. You know?
Yeah, forget those umpteen million years of evolution. They screwed up. We can do it better.
Okay. Bookchin goes back, and it's very complicated, but Bookchin basically develops a form of social Darwinism, for those of you that are familiar with that. Now, when most people say social Darwinism, they think of right-wing Herbert Spencer, you know, Huxley and everything. Bookchin produces a form of social Darwinism from the left. One of the better things I've done in my life, and I just fell into it, I wrote my master's thesis on a Russian anarchist named Peter Kropotkin. And basically, Bookchin bases off of Kropotkin and says, look, are humans capable of being competitive, nasty, mean? Well, of course they are. Are they capable of being cooperative and kind and loving? Well, of course they are. Well, then when you build institutions, what sort of behaviors do you reinforce? What sort of perspective do you bring? And Bookchin brings that kind of left-wing social Darwinism, which says cooperation, the phrase he gets from Kropotkin is mutual aid, is as much a part of us. This dominating and destroying nature is not part of us. We are not a failed species. But what we are is a species that's taken some wrong turns and are operating according to some pretty crappy incentives. What would, just a picture, what kind of institutions would we build if we wanted to reinforce cooperation? A, we'd have cooperatives. Okay? We'd scale that. We wouldn't work. I'm sure right now there are thousands of people in Africa mining metals that they have no idea what that's going to be used for. It's going to end up in some U.S. missile. It's all of that that goes into constructing our crisis. I don't know how much, it's interesting. He's incredibly cerebral. Now, on one point, he makes no bones about it. Human beings are different from and superior to every other species. Murray Bookchin is as much a humanist as the Pope. God, he gave that analogy. He doesn't want to have any truck with nature lovers. Okay? This is about political, social institutions and whether or not they liberate or oppress. I think it's good to occasionally talk about Murray Bookchin. I don't know, what major policy implications he's going to have. There was a time when he was having some impact in American colleges, some of the radical American colleges like God. He has this interesting though. If you're familiar with the neocons, and the author of Francis Fukuyama, okay. Francis Fukuyama wrote a book called The End of History, which is fascinating to look at Fukuyama and Bookchin. They're both Hegelians, they're both evolutionists, they both see human social institutions as mimicking evolution. But Fukuyama says advanced technological capitalism and liberal democracy is as far advanced as humans can get. We can't think of a better system than that. And therefore, if by history you mean human social evolution, we reached the end of it. Hence the title of his book. Bookchin is a counter to that. Bookchin says, no, advanced industrial capitalism is not the end of history. What the end of history is will probably be some decentralized, sustainable, small-scale community. It's really fascinating. They almost use the same authors and everything. Fukuyama, one last comment on him, to his credit, says the major assault on the neoconservative agenda, both domestically and foreign policy, comes from the environmentalists. Again, social ecology, ecological economics, these people are talking about radically different economic systems. Yes? Bookchin is talking about a radically different political system. They're both talking about the same ethical system.